Previously on the Aruba Switching Story. We've learned about the Edge Services platform and how Aruba Switching fits into the unified infrastructure portion of ESP. We've learned about our workflow where we need to plug in a security camera to be able to access a facial recognition application in the data center. We've learned how to provision the data center with the Aruba Fabric Composer. We've learned how data center bridging can help with Aruba data center switches. We provision the campus and learn the different methods of deploying campus infrastructure. We've learned how to securely onboard devices and segment traffic using dynamic segmentation and how it applies to our workflow. We've also understood PoE, Power over Ethernet, especially with the advanced capabilities of always-on and quick PoE. We've explored Virtual Switching Framework, or VSF, our front plane stacking solution. Next, we're going to hear from Vincent Giles and Steve Bartlett, who are going to talk about resiliency in AOSCX for the first part of this episode.
Yeah, thank you, Justin, for the introduction. I'm Steve Bartlett, and I'm joined by my colleague, Vincent Giles. We're both technical marketing engineers supporting CX switching. And this segment is all about high availability with AOSCX. There's four topics that we're going to be looking at in this segment, and I'm just going to quickly run through them. The first is AOSCX built-in resiliency, and we'll be looking at what happens when we have a critical component of the CX software stack and it fails. And we're looking at the impact of that. The second item, network resiliency with active circuits. So we'll be looking at the impact of failing an active circuit in multiple circuits that are active. And the third item, VSX resiliency with active nodes. So this is where we have two switches in a VSX cluster, both are active, both are forwarding traffic, and we simulate a failure of one of the switches in that VSX cluster. And we'll be looking at the impact of that as well. And lastly, we'll be looking at the VSX Live upgrade process, and that is within the VSX cluster, two active switches forwarding traffic in a critical area of the network. And we're looking at the impact, if at all, when we try to upgrade both of the switching software. So first things first, we're going to look at the CX built-in resiliency. So Vincent, can you tell us about the built-in resiliency of the Aruba CX operating system?
Sure, Steve. Let's have a look how our CX is designed and the associated outcomes for the network operation. CX is built on a centralized state database, which allows to keep processes separated and deliver a microservice modular architecture. This modularity is the key aspect that provides both the reliability of the switch itself and the agility in the development cycle for Aruba to deliver new features in a fast pace for customer requirements. All software components are modular and are programmed as daemons in a Linux-based system, as you can see here on the right from the show system resource utilization. The centralized state database is the central repository of all the switch information that are relevant to read or to write for each module. There is no direct interprocess communication pipeline any longer, but instead modules are exchanging information through this database. Here, the advanced diagnostic command shows both the switch state database that is persistent and the that is non-persistent, and the config database that is persistent. In this example, there are more than 100 processes that are monitoring information tables inside this OVSDB. For instance, you can see here the process VLANDI monitoring the various information tables for ports, VLAN, interfaces, and so on. The direct consequence is that if a module fails or restarts, it does not impact the health of the other processes. One other benefit is that if we create a new updated feature module, It can be plugged in this architecture without dependency on other modules. This offers a lot of agility for software development. It is important to note that the state database that is a data structure residing in RAM. So accessing this state DB is extremely fast. Here are some information on the live switch connecting our camera. So we can do a show system resource utilization and see here more than 200 processes communicating. This is those modules communicating and running in that Linux system. As well, in terms of diagnostic, I can do a diag dump DB basic. And we'll see the tables that are monitored by those processes. So here, as an example, the process line VLAND is monitoring the said tables that I was referring to before.
So Vincent, what does this mean in real-world operations? Does it mean that if a process crashes, there'll be no impact on the traffic?
In most cases, yes. Some processes are, of course, critical, like process that configure the forwarding ASIC. But for any control plane or management plane processes, a process restart does not impact the existing data plane traffic.
Oh, it sounds great. Can you demonstrate it for us, Vincent?
Let me show, as an example, what happened if the routing process is restarted. So here, in our topology, we are going to zoom on this specific part where we have our VXLAN video streaming traffic between the VSF stack access 1 and the leaf 2 in the data center. So camera 1 here is recording a screen that will be displayed in the face recognition application running on a virtual machine hosted in the ESXi server dual attached behind that leaf 2. On top of that streaming traffic that is going over the VXLAN tunnel, we are going to add 8 gigabit of XIA per second of XIA traffic to measure the impact on the traffic if it is interrupted. For that, we set up a layer 2 switch, a pure layer 2 switch here, 3810, dual attached to the 8325-3A and B. Note that in order to track the maximum impact on the traffic, XIA will show the worst flow performers from XIA flow detective feature and will sort them based on the camera frame delta. So this is the difference between the sent and the received frames per flow. So let's proceed with this demonstration now. So going back. I'm connected here on the face recognition machine on the left side. You see there is that is the remote display received on that application from the camera that is streaming live that traffic. And that camera is actually recording a screen where we have a video looping. And at the bottom right here, you see a PoE light panel that is flickering on the remote display. I can power cycle this PoE light on the right side to show that this setup is actually live. So for that, I'm back to my to the switch that is connecting those camera, and I'm going to power down this the PoE on that interface. So you see now that PoE light that is shut down. I'm going to restore that. And the flickering will be an easy way for us to check if there is any impact on that video stream flow. So very useful for us. So now that we have the video stream, let's start the XIA probe. So doing the starting the XIA, and I should see here zero in terms of packet loss duration. So that starts with a little bit 41 milliseconds of loss is due to the ARP learning on all the VTEP. So I'm going to stop and restart so that the ARP are already learned. Okay, so everyone learned the ARP. And when this is nominal situation, I should have 0 milliseconds here so that I can start my test with nominal conditions. Okay, here we go. We've got 0 milliseconds. So my XCR are now started. So let's first check that the routing, because I would like to restart the routing process. Let's check that the routing is absolutely required to pass the VXLAN traffic. So I'm going to passive the OSPF interface on the 6300 VSF to demonstrate that OSPF is needed for underlay routing. So let's do that. So this is here on my switch. I'm going to just check, for instance, the show IP route here. So we've got many routes coming from OSPF as an origin, and I can do a show IP OSPF neighbor details. And you see those neighbors that are up for last 5 days, for instance, or 1 day here. Now I'm going to passive that default. And as soon as I do that, you see the video on the left is completely frozen. And if I go to the Ixia, I've got a lot of packet loss here. So I'm going to stop this and restart OSPF. And as soon as the adjacencies are restored, you see the video is now passing over. So I can do a show IP OSPF details. And you see those neighbors are now up for the last 14 seconds. Good. So we now are sure that OSPF is required to pass that traffic. So what I'm going to do, restart Ixia first, nominal case. So this interrupting OSPF, the VTEP are no longer reachable as the loopback address is not populated any longer to the routing table. And this is why OSPF is required. So let's go to the shell now. So I'm going to explain what I'm going to do now. Here on that 6300 VSF, I'm going to start shell and to check what is the routing process and process ID, and I'm going to kill that process simply like that. And I'm going to identify as well, right after doing so, I will identify if there is any interrupt on the OSPF control plane, which should be the case. But the data plane should be left untouched and no traffic interruption. So let's see that. So going back to that switch, I'm going to do start shell. And now I'm going to do grep of any process containing routing. So there is a process called HP routing. So I'm going to kill that one. And as you can see, the video stream is not impacted. Let's check on Ixia here. 0 milliseconds loss, worst performer. So no impact at all on that flow. So this is, let me just check now the new process ID for routing. You see the former process ID here and the new process ID. So it has been restarted automatically. Now I can go back and check a few things like show IP OSPF neighbor details. And you can see here that 30 seconds or 23 seconds away, my process has been restarted for adjacency for OSPF. So this is no traffic impact as expected. This is due to the restart of the OSPF process happening before the dead timer expired on the neighbor for the adjacency. And secondly, due to the fact that the FIB in the ASIC is managed by a separate process that is left untouched while the routing process is restarted, so no interrupt on the data plane.
Well, that's a fantastic example, Vincent. So let me quickly summarize what we've seen. So we've had live traffic with video and Ixia over the EVPN VXLAN tunnel. And then we killed the routing process on the access switch connecting the camera. And we've seen it has no impact on the traffic flow. So am I correct in saying that this modular architecture provides two major outcomes? The first being automatic restart of crashed or failing processes. And the second, no data plane impact for control plane or management plane process restarts. This is thanks to the process isolation and central database that allows, you know, this such resiliency. So as you said earlier, the process managing the forwarding ASIC and the associated FIB are left untouched. And we saw that with the OSPF restart.
This is a perfect summary, Steve. This is exactly how CX has been designed for, to maximize the network uptime.
Thank you, Vincent and Steve, for explaining the resiliency of AOS CX. On our next episode, Vincent and Steve will return and discuss more about VSX, or virtual switching extension.